Hello students, in this lecture we will learn that how the cooling system of an IC engine works and why it is required. Okay, see, this is the schematic diagram of a four-stroke petrol engine. Okay, so what happens that we know there are four strokes, those are the suction, the compression, the working and the exhaust. Okay, so what happens in suction? It sucks the charge through the inlet valve, okay, inside the cylinder. Okay, then in compression, the same charge is compression. At the end of compression, a spark is introduced. Due to that, the entire fuel ignites. Okay, so by this way, heat is developed. Okay, then after combustion, the working stroke occurs, and at the end of working stroke, the exhaust valve opens and all the burnt gases are removed out. Okay, now what happens when heat is generated inside the cylinder? Okay, heat is generated, then only a portion of heat converts into work, because we know this thing that in heat engine what happens, the heat converts into work. So it is like this. Suppose I say that in a particular interval of time 100 joules of heat is developed in the cylinder. Okay, so practically more or less only 25 joules of heat will convert into work over the piston, because when piston works, then only the crankshaft rotates. Okay, so only 25 joules will convert into work. Rest of the 75 joules, almost 75% of heat is just waste. Okay, so what happens? Heat power is developed with certain rate inside the cylinder when the fuel is burned. Okay, what happens that inside the cylinder the fuel is reaching with some particular fuel flow rate. Okay, so with the same rate the heat is developed, because continuously fuel is going inside. Okay, so on an average with some particular rate the heat is developed inside the cylinder. Okay, and out of heat rate generated inside the cylinder, more or less 25% of heat is used for work development, rest of all is waste. I already told you, okay, that 25% of heat is converted into work over the piston and rest of the heat is just a waste. Okay, now most of the heat is carried away by the exhaust gases. Okay, what happens that when work ends, then ultimately the exhaust valve opens and exhaust gases are expelled out. So exhaust gases are hot. Okay, so they carry away heat with them. Okay, so most of the heat, you can say almost 35% of heat, is carried away with the exhaust gases. Now what happens that still 35% of heat developed has to be taken away in order to keep the cylinder temperature under control. Now why this term is there, temperature under control? Simple. What happens when heat is developed inside the cylinder? Okay, then this heat has to be dispensed out of the system with a particular rate so that the cylinder temperature is in under control. Why under control? Because the engine will perform its best at a particular optimum temperature. In case the temperature is either more than that temperature or less than that optimum temperature, the performance becomes poor. Okay, so what happens? The amount of heat developed inside is very much high. Okay, so in case we are not cooling the cylinder head, okay, in that case the temperature can go beyond that optimum temperature and it would lead to low level or poor performance of the engine, as well as other problems can also develop due to that thing. So once again, that the amount of heat developed inside the cylinder, only 25% is converted into work. Okay, rest of the 75% is a waste. So we have to manage the 75% of heat, which is a waste. Almost 35% of heat is carried away by the exhaust. Still much more heat is left, which is to be dispensed by some way so that the engine temperature can be under control. Now here I have written that what happens when cylinder temperature is not in control, means the temperature is going above the optimum temperature. First thing, in SI engines it can lead to knocking. Okay, high temperature in SI engine leads to knocking problem. Knocking itself is a ailment with an engine. Due to knocking, the engine life reduces as well as its performance also reduces. However, with high temperature in CI engines, there is no as such problem of knocking. Remember this thing. Okay, second problem is thermal deformations in engine peripherals can take place. Okay, we know this thing that engine peripherals are mostly made up of ferrous alloys. Okay, and piston is actually made up of aluminium alloy. Okay, so the aluminium alloy's melting point is around more or less 600 degrees centigrade. Okay, so in case we are reaching that temperature, suppose the piston is moving towards 600 degrees centigrade, then there are chances that piston becomes soft and due to the forces applied over the piston, it is deforming. Similarly, for the case of ferrous alloys also, with high temperatures, there are chances that they become soft and deformation can start. Okay, so a temperature more than a particular limit is actually harmful for engine peripherals. This thermal deformation is a problem of CI engine also. Okay, in CI engine, although with increasing temperature, knocking doesn't increases. Okay, this problem is only with SI engine, but in CI engine, the thermal deformation can happen with increasing temperatures. Okay, and the third thing is that it can reduce the life of lubricant oil. We know this thing that generally in engine's crankcase, okay, in case splash lubrication system is used, then in engine crankcase, the oil is kept. So in case temperature of cylinder is very high, then when oil is splashed and touches the cylinder inner surfaces, over there in case temperature is very high, then it can lead to burning of this oil. Okay, so more carbon formation will take place with lube oil and it will lead to temper the properties of lubricant oil. Okay, so these are the problem in case the temperature exceeds the optimum temperature for which the engine can run with its best performance. Okay, we know this thing that main heat source is the engine cylinder. It is also called as engine head. Okay, this cylinder is also called as engine head. Okay, so in case we are controlling the temperature over the engine head, everywhere temperature is controlled. Okay, so what happens, we have to adopt a cooling system to keep the temperature under control. Okay, that cooling system is actually applied over the engine head so that the excess amount of heat, okay, which is to be dispensed, okay, that heat is taken away by that cooling system. Okay, now how many types of cooling systems are there? One is direct air cooling, also called as air cooling. Only air cooling it is called as direct air cooling. Other is indirect air cooling, also called as water cooling, sometimes called as coolant cooling. Okay, so generally two types of cooling systems are used. One is direct air cooling, other is indirect air cooling. Direct air cooling is also called as air cooling only, and indirect air cooling is also called as water cooling. Now what is direct air cooling? Okay, direct air cooling is generally employed with small capacity engines, small moped engines. Okay, and in this case what is done, that over the cylinder head number of fins are implanted. Okay, you would have studied in heat transfer subject that in case we are implanting fins over some exposed surfaces, then heat transfer rate increases due to increment in the area of exposure. Okay, so same thing over the engine head, the fins are implanted so that when air of atmosphere touches those fins, then whatever the extra amount of heat which is developed inside the cylinder can be dispensed to the atmosphere by the help of those fins. And the dimensions of those fins are after proper calculations. Okay, so that only required amount of heat can be dispensed to the atmosphere, as well as no more material wastage can take place, because the fins are also made up of some material. Okay, so extra long fin is of no use. Okay, so the dimensions of these fins are actually optimized. Okay, so now what is the advantage of direct air cooling? Advantages, okay, first thing, it is cheap and simple to develop. Okay, what is done, just fins are implanted over the engine head. Okay, these are some projected entities over the cylinder head. Okay, so it is cheap as well as simple to develop. Second thing is, it doesn't requires any as such maintenance and running cost. Okay, means if fins are implanted over the cylinder head, then there is no as such maintenance. Okay, the life of these fins have no as such limit. Okay, so there is no maintenance cost in case direct air cooling is employed with an engine system. Okay, now what are the disadvantages? Okay, what happens, that first thing, that in case direct air cooling is used, then engine head must be exposed to the environment, because until and unless the engine head is exposed to the environment, how can air will interact with the fins and take away the heat? Okay, so this engine head has to be exposed to the environment. Second thing is, the cooling rate depends upon the atmospheric temperature. Okay, because we know this thing, that actually air is what taking away the heat of this cylinder. Okay, through these fins. Okay, what happens in summers, the temperature of air is high. Okay, and in winters the temperature of air is cold. Okay, so what happens, cold air has higher capacity to take away the heat compared to that of hot air. So in summers, less amount of heat transfer rate takes place through these fins, and in winters more amount of heat transfer rate takes place through these fins. Okay, so it totally depends upon atmosphere, that what will be the cooling rate. Okay, so more or less the amount of cooling which is required is achieved. Still, in case we want perfect cooling, okay, in case we want optimum cooling, then the air cooling or direct air cooling is not a particular solution. So these disadvantages have their significance in case of big capacity engines or multi-cylinder engines. The reason being, suppose it is a two-cylinder engine, okay, two or three or four-cylinder engine, okay, then to accommodate these fins, okay, we have to keep a big gap between the cylinders. Okay, first of all those four cylinders must be exposed to the atmosphere. Second thing is, there must be a particular gap so that these fins can be accommodated. Okay, so for car engines, okay, for car and four-wheeler engines which are compact in size, okay, over there we have not as such opportunity of keeping the cylinders exposed to the atmosphere as well as keeping the gaps in the cylinder. Okay, second thing is, in big capacity engines we require perfect cooling. Okay, so in case of air cooling, the cooling rate depends upon the atmospheric conditions. Okay, so for the case of big capacity engines and multi-cylinder engines, generally we don't adopt the direct air cooling systems. Okay, now we will learn that what is indirect air cooling. I am talking about this indirect air cooling or water cooling with a three-cylinder engine. Okay, for small cars, street cars, three-cylinder engines are used. Why it is called as indirect air cooling? Now I will tell. See, this is the cylinder, okay, and cylinders are implanted with coolant or water jacket. Okay, you can see this is a cylinder, and outside the cylinder there is one more vessel, okay, which is in connection with the outer surface of this cylinder. Okay, so this is the piston, this is the connecting rod, and this is the crankshaft. Okay, this is the indicative diagram of entire cooling system. Over here I am just focusing on the cooling system, indirect cooling system. Now one more main component, that is the thermostat valve, you can see. And one component, it is the radiator. Okay, and behind the radiator there is a fan, you can see, and there is a pump. Okay, now what is the method? Method is this, that there are no as such fins. Okay, there is a coolant, okay, which is generally a liquid. And what is the coolant? Water, plain water or distilled water, is mixed with some additives with it to improve its performance in connection with the cooling system. Okay, distilled water having some additives with it. Okay, so what happens, that you can see these are the ducts, also called as hose pipes. Okay, by the help of hose pipes the coolant flows. Okay, so coolant goes, and when enters this coolant jacket or water jacket, okay, this coolant touches the exterior surface of the cylinder. Okay, so whatever extra amount of heat which is developed inside the cylinder, which has to be dispensed to the coolant, that heat is dispensed to the coolant like this. Okay, so coolant comes with low temperature and absorbs the heat from the cylinder so that the cylinder temperature remains under control. Okay, so what will happen when the coolant will pass through the coolant jacket, absorb the heat of each cylinder, then it will become hot. Okay, that coolant is passed through the radiator. Okay, that's it. Because what happens, that if coolant will absorb the heat, its temperature will rise. Okay, so if we will allow its temperature to rise and the same hot coolant is again circulated back through this coolant jacket, then what will happen, it will not be able to take away the heat of the cylinder, extra heat of the cylinder. Reason being, that heat always flows from high temperature to low temperature. Okay, so what happens when the coolant passes through the coolant jackets, absorbs the heat of the engine, it becomes hot. That coolant is passed through a radiator. Okay, what is the radiator? In the radiator there is an arrangement so that coolant passes through some plates, okay, some passages through which air can also pass through. Okay, so what happens when the coolant passes through those plates or those passages and air is also passing through, so what will happen, whatever heat content is there with the coolant, that heat is supplied to the atmospheric air. So ultimately coolant again becomes cool and again it is ready to absorb the heat of the cylinders like this. So like this way, in a cyclic fashion, the coolant takes away the heat and ultimately the heat is dispensed to the air itself. This is the reason that it is called as what? Indirect air cooling. Reason being, that still heat is dispensed to the air. Okay, what is happening over here, that coolant is going, absorbing the heat, and ultimately coolant's heat is dispensed to the air, again coolant becoming cool and again ready to absorb the heat of the cylinders. Okay, so ultimately heat is dispensed to the air. Okay, in case of air cooling, heat is directly dispensed to the air through the fins, but here heat is first of all dispensed to the coolant, and from the coolant it is dispensed to the atmospheric air. So it is a sort of indirect air cooling. Okay, now what is the job of this fan? Okay, what happens in case this entire system, as I am showing you in the diagram, in case this entire system starts moving with sufficient speed from left to right, okay, then automatically air will come and collide with this radiator and take away the heat of the coolant. Okay, but in case the system is not moving with sufficient speed or is stationary, okay, in that case By some arrangement, we have to make the air to pass through the radiator. So for that case, this fan is required, okay, which forcefully pulls the air from the atmosphere and makes it to pass through the radiator, okay. And usually the fan is made to rotate by the help of some electric motor. Now, what is the job of this thermostat valve? This one more component I am showing over here. The job of this component is that suppose your car, overnight it was parked and in the morning you are starting the car, okay. So engine is too cold. What happens in the morning? Okay, suppose from last 12 hours you did not drive the car, okay. So in the morning when you are starting the engine, at that time the engine is too cold. What I told you, that engine performs its best when it is at optimum temperature, okay. So first of all, it has to reach to that temperature, then only we have to start the cooling system, because cooling is required when the temperature crosses the optimum temperature, okay. So when engine is very cold, at that time the cooling is not required. So what happens, what is the job of this thermostat valve? That when engine is cold, when it is just started, okay, then in that case it stops the coolant to pass through the radiator, okay. Pump is working, pump is taking the coolant and forcing the coolant to pass through the jacket, and ultimately that coolant doesn't pass through the radiator, okay, it is again circulated back. So what will happen, whatever heat which is collected by the coolant, in case that coolant is not passing through the radiator, then its temperature will not fall, okay. So that hot coolant will again pass through the jackets of this engine, okay. So in that case, fastly the engine temperature will reach the optimum temperature, understood? Because in case coolant is not passing through the radiator, then I told you, in that case coolant itself will not cool, okay. So hot coolant when will pass through the jackets, it will lead to rapid reaching of engine to its optimum temperature, at which it will perform its best, okay. Once that optimum temperature is reached, in that case we have to start the cooling system. In that case, automatically this thermostat valve senses that temperature and doesn't allows the coolant to pass through like this. It allows the coolant to pass through the radiator, okay. In that case, this loop, this cycle will take place, okay, because when optimum temperature is reached, okay, we don't want to cross that temperature, in that case cooling is required. Now the thermostat valve will sense that, okay, so it is temperature sensing device, okay. As soon as the coolant crosses a particular temperature, that is usually 70 degrees centigrade, okay, at that temperature it starts the coolant to pass through the radiator, okay. In that case, actual cooling starts, okay. Before that, in case engine is too cold, in that case it senses the temperature and doesn't allow the coolant to pass through the radiator, and a short circuit type of arrangement takes place, okay, so that the engine can reach to the optimum temperature rapidly, okay. So hope you would have understood by this small lecture that what is cooling system of engine, why it is required, what is air cooling and what is water cooling. Thank you.